You're watching the latest edition of the Wellness Hour, the leader in medical news and information. I'm Randy Alvarez. Today's topic, what you need to know if you are considering breast augmentation. My advice, stick around for the latest edition of the Wellness Hour.
The Wellness Hour, an in-depth discussion with today's top physicians and medical leaders. And now, your host, Randy Alvarez.
You're watching the latest edition of the Wellness Hour, the leader in medical news and information. I'm Randy Alvarez. My first guest is Dr. Steven Zucker. Dr. Zucker is the founder of Plastic Surgery Center in South Bend, Indiana. We've invited him on the program today to discuss what you need to know if you are considering any type of breast surgery. Dr. Zucker, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me on your show.
Good. Now, before we get into today's topic, tell us a little bit about your practice. By the way, I've been told you're the go-to guy for breast augmentation.
Right.
But you do more than that.
We do it all, Randy. I've been in practice in South Bend, Indiana for 23 years. We do facial plastic surgery. We do breast augmentations. We do breast reductions and reconstructions. We do injection fillers for wrinkles, Botox, Restylane. It's pretty much a comprehensive, all-inclusive
so
practice.
Your background, your training, board-certified plastic surgeon.
That's right. I did all my training in the Midwest, University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. Did my internship at the University of Wisconsin in Madison, did complete general surgery training at University of Iowa in Iowa City, back to Ann Arbor again for plastic surgery training.
Did you always know you wanted to be, when did you know you wanted to do plastic surgery?
I made up my mind to become a plastic surgeon when I was a scrub technician at University Hospital in Ann Arbor in the very early 70s. The team there was headed up by Dr. Reed Dingman, very famous name in plastic surgery.
Okay.
And the professors there made a deep and lasting impression on me. It was pivotal in my decision making, really. I was kind of under the totem pole. I was hired to pass instruments, but I remembered everybody I met, everything I saw, and I went back there for my professional training.
Okay, now your staff, one of the things I liked about you on the telephone, because everybody always says, I have a great staff, but you, I mean, you believe it.
Oh, I really do.
And they've been there a long time.
From the beginning, I'm very proud of my employees. I've got the best. I hired Bobby as my office manager. She's been with me for 21 years. Barbara has been my transcriptionist for 20 years. My nurses have worked with me for 15, 16, 18 years. We have very little turnover. It has made for a lot of stability, and that pays a benefit to the patient.
Why? How so?
Because they enter a smoothly running, well-oiled machine, a good system.
Interesting.
That hit the ground running 20 years ago and continues to this day. And all of my people know what they're doing. They know how to talk to patients, how to make them feel good from the beginning. The patient, remember, goes to you for a reason. And if they come in and they sense that the people there are practiced and polished at what they're doing, it immediately gives them a very deep sense of comfort, and they like that.
Now, your surgeries, where do you do your surgeries?
We do all of our cosmetic surgery on site in the office. I built Plastic Surgery Center with a view toward taking the cosmetic surgery out of an institutional setting and putting it in a private setting where we could control the quality, lower the cost, and keep it on an individual one-on-one basis.
Moving on to today's topic, breast augmentation or breast surgery, what are the different categories of patients you see for breast surgery?
I think of my patients basically as presenting in two different ways. There is the younger woman who comes in before children, and then there's the patient who comes in after children. And things change, as all the women know. Our younger patients tend to be students or young professionals. They're healthy, they're motivated, and they're active socially. They want to look good in clothing, fill out a blouse and bra to good advantage, and have their appearance complement their shoulders and their hips.
Are the patients getting older and older, are they getting younger and younger?
There are those patients who come in after they have raised their children. And that's the second category of patients. That's the lady who's raised and probably breastfed 2, 3, 4 kids. And she comes in and typically says to you, I want my breasts to look the way they did before I had kids.
All right.
And so there is sometimes a little, shall we say, retailoring that needs to go along with that. The typical plan has a few challenges to it. There's issues of size, symmetry and droop. And the symmetry and the droop is usually what comes out as time goes by.
Let's start there. How do you decide size? A woman comes in on a consult. What happens?
You listen, basically. And I like to say to my patients, tell me in your own words, what do you hope to get out of this operation? What do you want it to do for you in practical terms?
Isn't that obvious? They just want to be a little bigger?
No, it's not at all obvious.
Okay.
And what the important thing to remember is that what I may think is obvious isn't necessarily obvious to the patient. You have to put yourself in their position.
Okay.
They're likely a little shy about the whole thing, feeling just a little bit intimidated. And you have to draw that information out of them and then give them the spur to talk, and then listen very carefully to what they say.
On the consult, you mark them up a little bit?
All of them.
Are you taking measurements?
Yes.
Okay.
I measure from the collarbone, from the breastbone. I measure from the crease up to the tip of the nipple. And that tells me where the nipple is. It tells me anatomically where I want it to go. And it tells me how much soft tissue I have to work with. And that's when we begin to look at the dimension of the implant and fit the implant to the patient. In other words, I have to have muscle, I have to have skin, I have to have a certain amount of fat, and I have to line it without having a tight fit. And that is how you define your framework. That tells you what you have to work with. And then you begin to think and explain to the patient, do we have the wherewithal to set this up the way you want it?
Do they bring in their partner, their spouse?
Hopefully they do.
Oh, really? Hopefully.
Sure. Because you want them to go home to a supportive home environment where somebody is there to help them take care of themselves.
Okay.
And if their partner isn't happy, then she may not be happy. And you want to make sure that you're doing this for the patient, not for the partner, of course. But it's always best if they come in with a supportive home background. And we always ask that to make sure that they've got somebody who can fix them a sandwich, bring them their pill, help them with a bandage, take them by the elbow and bring them up to the table. That's all important.
As far as advances in breast surgery, anything new in the last 20 years, or I'm sure what is new?
I think the biggest, latest development has been the reintroduction of the newer silicone gel breast implants. The older product, I think, was basically a good product, but it was not studied enough. It wasn't controlled well enough. And since 1990, the whole subject has come under a great deal of scrutiny, and it's all been for the better, because the newer product is a better product.
Why is it better?
It's better.
And you're talking in terms of a gel-filled or silicone?
Correct. That's
okay.
Right.
And why is it better?
It's better, I think, because the industry has come up with something that doesn't break up. And actually, I can show you.
Sure. Let's take a look. So what are we looking at here?
This is a new silicone gel breast implant. Okay. It's a smooth, round product.
Okay.
And if you take it in your hand,
right. Okay.
You can see it has a certain softness.
Yep.
And this is a saline-containing implant, which is empty. It is a good product too, but this is a newer development.
So is one is more like a water balloon,
mm-hmm.
and one is more like flesh. This feels like flesh.
That's
fleshy.
Right, and it has a soft contour. That's
okay.
Why. That's what makes it appealing. Now they each have their advantages. We can get the saline implant through a slightly smaller incision. They tend to feel perhaps just a little firmer. The newer gel implant requires a slightly longer cut, perhaps, but it is a softer feeling implant.
Is that your implant of choice, though? Silicone or gel filled?
The implant of choice is what the patient wants.
Okay.
Whichever one they feel more comfortable with is probably the better call.
Of
and
those
we use
two,
them both.
Does one look more natural than the other?
No, I don't think so. I think
but
it's more
feel,
in terms of feel.
But the silicone feels more natural.
That's right. It's softer, basically.
Tell me about, and anticipating this interview,
mm-hmm.
talk to some women about this, and some strong opinions about where, you know, in the armpit, I guess, in the fold, through the nipple area, through the belly button.
Uh-huh.
What are your suggestions?
Most times we go in and the fold underneath. That bears directly on how much skin they have to work with.
Okay.
Many times women are a little bit plumper at the bottom, what we call the lower pole, the bottom of the breast, right where it joins the chest wall. And that's a great place to put an incision because it heals well, it blends in with the skin texture lines nicely, and it gives you good exposure. Technically speaking, it's a useful incision to make.
Is it the best one to hide the incision?
Depends how much soft tissue they have.
Okay.
If they have just a little bit of excess or a little redundancy, it oftentimes will gather down at the bottom and do a wonderful job of covering an incision in that area. Now, by contrast, if you have a woman who is very, very little developed and her skin is tight, oftentimes the nipples are paradoxically just a little bit large, then any incision you put on the chest wall is going to show, and it's going to be difficult to cover. That is an excellent combination of characteristics, features, to make an incision at the edge of the nipple where it blends with the white skin of the breast.
What about the sensation when you go in through the nipple area?
Occasionally, it can happen. But more, I think, that happens by making an overdeveloped pocket to take the implant. Now, the other incisions that you hear about and everybody knows about, the incision in the armpit. I used to do that. I've become less enthusiastic about that one.
Okay.
It's summertime. People are getting ready for the beach, and they oftentimes will be in sleeveless tops. Don't really want an incision in the top of the armpit, and it's hard to work with. It's harder to control the size of the pocket and the level of the implant. And so I've gotten away from that. And I must say, I don't have any respect for that.
You don't like it at all. You have strong opinions about this.
I would not consider an incision through the umbilicus.
So you think it's a mistake?
Button.
Oh, in the belly button area.
I respect the incision in the armpit. That is a worthy approach, and there is something to be said for it. I've just gotten away from it. I really don't have much respect for that incision through the belly button.
Not at all.
No.
Think it's gimmicky?
Yes.
Is anybody even doing that in Indiana?
I don't know.
Okay.
I can tell you I'm not.
Okay. All right. How much art, and I told you, my impression was pretty straightforward breast augmentation, but how much art, how much science, if you had to put a percentage on it?
Sure. There's art and there's science. I don't really know how to break it down except to say that you have to appreciate both when you do this. And really, I can show you that.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Here's a good place to start. This is, I guess you could call this a quote-unquote average case. If you look at this patient, you see that she is rather underdeveloped. And in the post-op photo down over here, look at the soft curve she's got at the bottom of the breast. And over here you see that shadowing. Shadowing gives you depth.
Shadow under the breast.
And dimension. It shows you that a change has taken place. Flat surfaces don't give you shadow.
So when, in your mind, a great breast augmentation is one that
looks natural.
Okay.
It doesn't have an
like straight ahead
quality. It blends with the rest of the patient and it flows with her anatomy.
So you are in control of that part underneath the breast.
You're in control of all of it, but you have to be sensitive to what you have to work with, so you take the patient's best features and you bring it out. Let me show you another photo. Many times my patients will ask me about cleavage, and that's really mostly genetics, but working within that, you do have an influence. You can